Hello, Behind the Habit. This is Father Robert Murphy of the Society of Jesus, the Central and Southern Province, also known as the Jesuits. And people often wonder, like, how did y'all get that name? You know, how do you go from Society of Jesus to Jesuits? Well, from our spirituality, St. Ignatius wanted to focus on Jesus in his spiritual exercises. And so when he went to name the order, he decided to call it the Society of Jesus. And people were like, hey, wait a minute. Like, what's going on with that? Like, are y'all trying to be like little Jesuses? And he's like, well, actually, yeah. And so in Spanish, Jesus, and you put ita at the end to make it diminutive. And so you get Jesuita. And so the little Jesuses, the Jesuits. And so we're going to talk to you today about the Jesuits and our vocation. And I'm actually coming to you from on the road. I'm actually at the SEEK 2021 conference with the Focus Missionaries here in the library at a diocesan high school while the conference is going on. And I can think of no better place, because part of the core of our mission, our ministry, is to be a missionary, to go out and about. See, St. Ignatius traveled a lot in his life. And so he went to the Holy Land and he came back, and he always wanted to go back to the Holy Land to work with non-Christian peoples. But when he couldn't go there, he just said, well, how can we serve the church? And so he put the Jesuits at the service of the church. And so the Pope started sending the Jesuits out. And so that's how you get St. Francis Xavier going to Asia to be this great missionary, because that's where the Pope saw a need, and that's where the Pope sent the Jesuits. And so the Jesuits still honor this by certain Jesuits take a vow of obedience to the Pope for mission. And so you might be thinking, like, well, does Father Murphy have that vow? And no, I don't, but it's not because what you're thinking. I haven't taken my final vows yet. And you might be like, what do you mean, Father Murphy? Like, you're a priest and a Jesuit and a religious. Don't religious order priests take their final vows before they get ordained? And that's usually the case. But in the Jesuits, as you'll come to see, we do things differently. And so we don't take our vows until after we finish our formation. And I just finished the last piece of my formation, which happens a few years after, time to go and reflect on our vows. It's a time to look at our sacred documents, to talk about community, to make the spiritual exercises again. And so I actually did this last year in the fall. I was in Dublin, Ireland, with those guys in the middle from all over the world. And then in the spring, I went to Kakuma, Kenya, to work at a refugee camp. But I'm getting ahead of ourselves, because that is the end of our formation, tertianship. And so let's go back to the beginning, religious life. And so how long is it? Well, 11 years. And so you have to wait for it. It's something that takes time. And so on our call today, we're going to go through, we're going to walk you through our formation. And so we're going to take you to the novitiate, to first studies, to regency, to theology. And this takes 11 years. Because we have to learn how to be Jesuits, and we have to learn about our spirituality. We have to learn how to serve in our different ministries. But one thing you don't have to wait for in the Jesuits is our habit. And so you'll get that after 2 weeks, and you might say, well, what is our habit? Whoa, y'all look like just a bunch of priests. Well, St. Ignatius decided that the habit that we would have is whatever local clergy wear. And since local clergy, diocesan priests wear clerics or the Roman collar, that's what we wear, even though we're not priests yet. And so that's when we're doing ministry, that's what we wear. And speaking of our ministries, what are they? Well, we're kind of in three big categories. The first one is our retreat houses and our parishes. The second one is our schools and universities. And the other one is our social ministries and our work with refugees. And so we're going to give you a taste of these different ministries today and travel to some of the places where we do these different ministries. And our ministries are broken up. The Jesuits break up the world into provinces. And so we're in the central and southern province. And so our apostolates are kind of spread out through there. And so you'll see that our province goes from New Mexico over to Florida, up to Colorado, to Missouri, out to Belize and Puerto Rico. And so we're going to travel around this province today. I know it's going to be virtually, but we're going to try to get you the feel to like be on mission with us. And so are you ready? Are you ready to go with us on mission to go to the different parts of our province to see different parts of ministries Jesuits do, to meet different guys in our formation process? So what are we waiting for? Let's go. Let's go down to Puerto Rico, where some of our novices are ready to talk to you.
Well, saludos, everyone, and welcome from San Juan, Puerto Rico. My name is Richard Jobert. I'm from New Orleans, and we're coming to you live from our community chapel.
So my name is Manuel Luna Vega, and I'm from Aibonito, Puerto Rico, and we are second year novices on spearmint in my island. And spearmint is a time in the Norwegian when we go out and minister and serve in order to experience and understand what it's like to live in a typical Jesuit community.
So what is the novitiate exactly? Well, our novitiate's located in Grand Coteau, Louisiana. You can see a picture of some of the works here. And our novitiate's located in St. Charles College, picture up there as well. What do we do in the novitiate? Well, in the novitiate, we learn how to be Jesuits. And our primary focus is learning how to pray as Jesuits. And we do that through the spiritual exercises, where we come to develop and deepen our relationship with Jesus Christ. We hear his call, and we learn how to go out and to labor with him and for him under the banner of his cross. Well, in the novitiate, in addition to learning how to be Jesuits through prayer, we learn about our society. So we look at the origins, we take classes on our constitutions and our general congregations. And of course, we learn about the vows. During that time, we're also sent out into apostolic works. So all around Grand Coteau and Baton Rouge and Lafayette, we go out and some guys work in nursing homes, other guys work in schools. We spend time getting to know the community, entering into the context. Also during our novitiate, as Manuel said, we're sent out into experiments where we're sent to really experience firsthand the Jesuit life, to test our vocations and to experience the vows. Since being a Jesuit novice, I've been missioned to communities in New York, here in Puerto Rico, in Houston, and of course, Grand Coteau.
Also, the novitiate is a moment of deepen your vocation and relationship with the Lord. Also, we as religious, we come from different backgrounds, like people were working or they were doing some studies. And the novitiate is a time to slow down, to have a moment of individual prayer, communal prayer, formation, doing apostolic service that is the fruit of our prayer. And that make us to help us to grow in freedom and integrate our life as religious. Also, another aspect of the novitiate that helps us to follow Christ with pure intention is the spiritual exercise. It's an experience of 30 days of silence, following the Lord to see where God wants us to follow him more dearly. One of the experiences that captivate my imagination of the exercise is that call of the king. I'm a chess player, and I feel very passionate about chess, and having that contemplation, seeing how the Lord called me to follow back under his banner of the cross, to fight for those values of the kingdom, put my heart out with consolation and at ease. And I know that I'm imperfect, that I don't, maybe I have some flaw, but he put his trust in me and made me to follow it more dearly because he's with me always in every moment.
Yeah, in addition to hearing that call of Christ the King, I think for me, my favorite part of the exercises was praying with the Nativity, using my imagination and entering into the scene, which that Trinity, the Holy Trinity looks out into the world and sees the world as it is and is so moved that it wants to enter into the world in order to save us. And in my prayer, I could hear Christ calling me, literally pulling me with his hand, bringing me into this work to labor for souls.
For me, another aspect that I love of our spirituality is that moment when we take time to really examine. As novices, we're encouraged to really examine twice a day. And it's very valuable for us because it's a moment to step back and to see how God is working within us throughout the day and also with the people that we encounter in our apostolate. Also, Richard and I that have now missioned here to Puerto Rico have a very powerful experience how like our formation in the novitiate have formed our heart to be more attentive to the needs of our apostolate here in the parishes or the schools or the social apostolate that we have in the island. I've been very amazed how that sensibility that we gain in the spiritual exercise or in the classes or in times of silence have helped us to see Christ more dearly in the people that we serve.
So what happens at the end of the novitiate? Well, after the 2 years, a man is invited to take vows. These are our first vows, and these vows are of poverty, chastity, and obedience. These are not simple vows, right? These are lifelong vows. And so after first vows, a Jesuit is sent to First Studies. And so now we'd like to turn it over to a Jesuit community of First Studies in St. Louis. We'll turn it over to Brother Sullivan and John Guerra.
Welcome to the library of our Jesuit First Studies community. My name is John Guerra, and I'm a scholastic, which means I'm a Jesuit in formation to be a priest.
And I'm Sullivan McCormick, a Jesuit brother, which means I serve the people of God through the vows of poverty, chastity, and obedience. The brother vocation is to live the Jesuit mission and identity to the core as a companion of Jesus. I felt called to the brother vocation in large part because of the idea of being a brother. I receive a lot of fulfillment when people feel comfortable opening up, sharing their story, struggles, and joys, and ideally a brother is someone you want to share with.
And we're both Jesuits in the same religious community in St. Louis, Missouri. Our community is called a First Studies community because it's the first place you are sent on mission to study after your perpetual vows in the novitiate. So our community is made up of 27 young Jesuits on mission from all around the country to study philosophy, theology, and various other subjects as a part of our formation to be Jesuit brothers and priests. So the purpose of our studies is to understand the context of our mission, to better understand the circumstances surrounding the people we serve and what the church teaches, and proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ.
John and I are both doing our studies at St. Louis University, a Jesuit Catholic university. I've been focusing on philosophy for studies, and I have a passion for social justice work, such as anti-racism work. At SLU, I've been able to take a wide range of classes in social work, theater, education, and theology as well. And while taking classes at SLU, I also do ministry at a nearby elementary school in North St. Louis called St. Louis Catholic Academy, where I get to work with the African-American community.
And I'm studying philosophy, Latin, theology, and music. But what I love the most is studying and writing about beauty in philosophy studies. And I compose sacred music for the liturgy. My apostolic ministry is with the sick, the poor, and the marginalized in our local community. I minister and give out Holy Communion to the sick at our Jesuit University Hospital and help the poor and homeless through a program here at our Jesuit Parish Church. I help them with immediate needs, legal work, and this type of work that will open job opportunities to them and housing opportunities. And sometimes I keep the night shift at our men's shelter on cold nights in the winter.
John and I both first encountered the Jesuits at Jesuit high schools. That was where our vocations were fostered and cultivated. These Jesuits we encountered helped form us in the Catholic faith and taught us about Jesuit life. I attended Jesuit Dallas High School, and then later attended Boston College, while John attended Jesuit High School in New Orleans. Jesuits not only teach in colleges and universities, they also teach in high schools and special elementary schools with a special mission to reach the poor and the marginalized of society. In addition to teaching, Jesuits work in various roles as administrators, campus ministers, and chaplains. There are over 800 Jesuit institutions throughout the world. We are currently in one of the 200 colleges and universities now.
So why do Jesuits care so much about education? Why do we run so many schools at every level of intellectual development? We have this saying in Latin, cura personalis, which means care of the whole person. When Jesuits teach, they try to care for a person, but the whole person. We believe an individual's personal happiness, freedom, and flourishing is inseparably linked with their relationship with our good and merciful God. Our mission is to spread the good news of Jesus Christ and to bring every student into a profound encounter of God and hopefully to change their life. In other words, our mission is human flourishing. We believe that the core Christian values of sacrifice, openness to growth, self-gift, service, deep spirituality, tradition, and community all serve to orient a person to God and his way of loving and seeing the world. Our mission in our schools is the same for everybody in the school community. So it's not just students, but also teachers and staff. And for us, that is an entirety of our mission in our flesh that we are bringing to that place. So it's not just teaching and it's not just administration, but it's to lead every single person, a part of our institutions, to a better life and so contribute to a better and holier church and a society that praises reverence and reverences and serves Jesus.
We hope this gave you a quick look at some of our educational apostolates and a little bit of what it's like to be a Jesuit in studies. As we continue our mission to study as Jesuits, we ask for your prayers and support, and we promise we will be studying, working, and praying for you. With that, we will pass it over to Ian Peoples in Belize.
Thanks, Soli and John. As I said, I'm in Belize, and the reason I'm not in the Roman collar is because the priests here most often wear guayaberas. So that is what I'm wearing. So this is the local priest garb. So in case you don't know, Belize is a small country located on the eastern coast of Central America. It's just south of Mexico and north of Guatemala. As you can see, it's a beautiful place to pass the winter months. I've very much been enjoying it. I've only been here 4 months so far, so very new to the place, but loving it. So regency is a stage of formation in which a Jesuit lives and works full-time in a Jesuit apostolic community. Many Jesuits are missioned to a high school for their regency, as John and Sully were saying, where they'll teach theology and other subjects, as well as take part in the life of the school. Others, however, such as myself, are missioned to do social apostolic work, which includes prison ministry, work with migrant people, with the homeless, and so on. Our superiors ultimately decide where we go for regency, but they do take into account our experiences and desires in that discernment process. And one of the key desires for my own discernment was the desire to proclaim God's mercy to others. That experience of God's mercy is key in my own decision to become a Jesuit. And in receiving that mercy, I felt called to spend my life proclaiming it to others. And that proclamation is really at the heart of the Jesuit mission. And so I get to live out that desire during my regency here, working as a prison chaplain and a campus minister. So I work with juvenile offenders at Wagner's Youth Facility in Belize Central Prison. And my job involves a lot of different things, but a lot of it is pastoral counseling, one-on-one, just talking with the young men there. Also providing programs like Bible study, providing guidance and prayer, doing life skills workshops. And I'm also teaching some of the guys how to pray, how to read, excuse me. Literacy is an issue here. And so as you see on this photo, this Christmas, we put on a Christmas play for the administration at the prison. This is my first go at being a director. I'm not typically a theater guy, but the guys had a lot of fun with it. As you can see, all we had for costumes were sheets, but we made it work and the guys had a lot of fun. And it was a really joyful celebration. So I'm also campus minister at our high school in Belize City, St. John's College High School. And besides SJC, as we call St. John's, we have a couple parishes in Belize, as you can see on the slide here. St. Martin de Porres, or Matins, as the people call it here, is in Belize City. And St. Peter Claver in Punta Gorda, which is in the southern part of the country. And the Jesuits are really intimately linked with the history of the country, particularly through our work at St. John's College. And that's been a real consolation for me to know, you know, that I'm standing on the shoulders of all these great men who have come here and served, also, you know, local Belizean Jesuits who have just done wonderful things for their community. So that's really humbling for me. Per social apostolic work, this ministry, there are two interrelated reasons why I appreciate this type of work, particularly as I'm experiencing it here in Belize. First, I'm involved in the wider community on a regular basis. Although the pandemic has affected this dramatically, Belize is still under strict lockdown, I've had the opportunity to meet many people involved in different sectors. That obviously includes the church, but also education, social work, criminal justice, gang intervention groups, and so much more. And this has helped me come to know the country and the city a bit better, which is good since I only visited once before arriving for Regency. An important part of my mission is simply come to know and learn from the people I hope to serve. And this is especially important in Belize since it's such a small country. Belize City is the largest city and it has just 57,000 people. And so in this really compact environment, it's really discernible and tangible how different issues affect one another. For example, gang activity and education, all these things are linked. And so I'm learning a lot about that. And the second reason why I love this work is there's a particular type of freedom involved in the social apostolate. As I come to know the place, the people, the issues that impact them, I can respond in turn, and I can work with the community to respond in turn. So for example, gang activity, as I said, is very prevalent in Belize City. Most, if not all, of the juvenile offenders at Wagner's are there because of gang involvement, most often murder charges. And since I arrived in October, over a dozen young men in the city have been murdered through gang violence. In my researching the issue, I learned that youth usually get involved in gang life at 13 years old. And so to respond to the situation, I'm working with a local Belizean woman to start an after-school program called Football for Life. And we intend for it to be a community-based solution that uses football or soccer to provide a safe space to learn and to mature spiritually, academically, socially. And this is nothing short of providential for me, since my brother Jesuits can tell you I'm an annoyingly passionate soccer fan. And the fact that God is giving me the opportunity to form youth using soccer is just another affirmation of this vocation. And so I could sum up my mission similar to one of the graces we pray for in the spiritual exercises, which is to know Christ more clearly, to love him more dearly, and to follow him more nearly. My work here is to come to know Christ present in the people, to love them, and to follow Christ in serving their needs to the best of my ability. And so I hope you got a little sense of Belize. And with that, I'll pass you a few thousand miles north to Brian Strasburger, Deacon Brian Strasburger in Boston.
Great. Thanks, Ian. As you said, my name is Brian Strasburger, and I'm coming to you from Boston, Massachusetts. After Regency, Jesuits spend 3 years studying theology, usually at either the Jesuit School of Theology in Berkeley, California, Regis College in Toronto, or here at Boston College. We take classes in scripture, pastoral studies, systematic theology, church history and ethics, along with practical classes to improve our preaching, learn how to hear confessions, and how to preside at Mass. Along with our studies, we also engage in local ministry in the community, just like John and Sullivan in First Studies. For example, I'm the chaplain of the BC men's basketball team. We haven't won a lot of games, including today's game, but it's fun to join the team for practice and games. Last year, I also worked in prison ministry, bringing communion to inmates every Sunday morning before the pandemic shut things down. This year, I'm a transitional deacon, so I'm helping out at a local parish. I assist at Mass, and I preach on a regular rotation. Our theology communities are also representative of the global nature of the Society of Jesus. As the largest male religious order, the Society of Jesus is present in 112 countries around the world. You might also be familiar with the fact that Pope Francis himself is a Jesuit from Argentina. He maintains a close relationship with Jesuits, and he usually visits the local community whenever he travels internationally. When he came to the U.S. in 2015, for example, for the World Meeting of Families in Philadelphia, he visited the Jesuit St. Joe's University, and he blessed a statue that celebrates Jewish and Catholic collaboration. Jesuits come from across the country, but also from across the world to study theology at our theologates, like here at Boston College. In our seven houses here, we have 65 Jesuits from 24 different countries. For example, just down the hall from me here in Hurtado House, there's Somme, a Jesuit from Burkina Faso in Africa. Further down is Gustavo from Uruguay in South America. And right below me is Michael from Malaysia. Such a diverse collection of Jesuits. While most Jesuits spend their lives living and serving in their home province, there are also opportunities for ministry and collaboration across provinces. For example, during my time in First Studies, I spent a summer in South Africa working for Jesuit refugee services. I accompanied home-based care workers and helped design a program for women who were survivors of sexual and gender-based violence. And for my regency, I spent 2.5 years in Nicaragua, where I worked at a Jesuit-founded nonprofit called John the 23rd. I helped run small business development projects in rural communities, and I ran a program for youth formation that involved field trips to local cultural heritage sites. I love being part of such a global religious order. In fact, that was a big part of my vocation to become a Jesuit. I grew up in Denver, Colorado, where I went to Regis Jesuit High School and then college at St. Louis University. After 8 years of Jesuit education, I was sure of one thing. I was never going to be a Jesuit. Don't get me wrong, I had good experiences with Jesuits, but I felt called to the married life and having a family. I was convinced I was going to end up as a math teacher and a basketball coach at a Jesuit high school. But first, after graduating college in 2006, I joined a postgraduate volunteer program called the Augustinian Volunteers. I went to Durban, South Africa, where I worked at an orphanage and an AIDS hospice. There are more people living with HIV/AIDS in South Africa than any other country in the world. It was the hardest I've ever worked in my life, but it's never been easier to wake up in the morning because I believed so strongly in what I was doing. I felt like I was living the gospel every day. Jesus tells us that when we feed the hungry, clothe the naked, and care for the sick, we're ministering to him. I felt so close to Jesus and the work we were doing in South Africa. When I was in college, people used to ask me, what do you want to be when you grow up? And I would respond, happy. I wanted to be happy. During that year in South Africa, I started thinking for the first time, what if the thing that would make me happiest, the most fulfilled, was dedicating my life to the gospel? That was the trigger of my Jesuit vocation. Now today, living in an internationally diverse community like here in Boston has been a real blessing. Every dinner table conversation brings a diversity of perspectives and insights. Did I read something about the political situation in Zimbabwe today? Well, I can ask Isaac, a Jesuit from Zimbabwe, about it. Being part of an international order gives us opportunities to travel and minister abroad. My own international experiences have broadened my horizons and opened my mind. Don't get me wrong, it can be challenging to step outside our comfort zone. When I was first missioned in Nicaragua, I didn't speak Spanish. But you have to challenge yourself in order to grow. And right now, the combination of theology studies and living in an international community are helping to shape and form me as a Jesuit as I prepare for my priestly ordination in June. Now let me turn it over to Father David Lugo in Spain.
Hey, thanks, Brian. My name is Father David Lugo, and I'm coming to you from where it all began for us as Jesuits here in Spain. I'm in Madrid, Spain, and as you see on this map here, I come from Houston, as you see in the background, and I am now living in Spain. In the foreground, you see a little map of the life of Ignatius Loyola and his journeys within the country of Spain. As you probably well know, the Society of Jesus began with his conversion, the conversion of St. Ignatius in his family castle up in the north of Spain, up where you see Loyola. This one man's experience of the living God changed his life. And as he recovered after a near-death experience not too far from his hometown in Pamplona, he dreamt of a life dedicated to the service of God and the salvation of souls. And from that dream that he felt as he laid there sick and recovering, was eventually born the Society of Jesus that you're hearing about right now. And from this small town in the north of Spain, forgotten by the Western world now, in Loyola, where no one seems to know or go, from there was born this international order. I was missioned back here to Spain after my ordination to the diaconate. When I was ordained a deacon, I was given a special mission to begin a special kind of formation in the society that requires a man to dedicate considerable time and effort to focus study. As you know, most of our men, after they finish the stage of formation that Brian just described, will get straight to work in the apostolate. There are some of us, though, that are given a mission to work in deepening our understanding of different areas of academic research. Since our foundation, you see here two images of St. Ignatius. Since our beginning, Ignatius wanted us to be learned priests. It was a moment of crisis in the church where a lot of priests were struggling to have a good sense of what was a good understanding of the gospel. Their formation was lacking. And so he wanted an order of learned men, which is clearly seen in the many years that Father Robert described earlier and that you've seen laid out over the course of this presentation. In my case, after my ordination this past August to the priesthood, there you see me laying prostrate at our church in St. Louis. After that ordination, which was a huge gift from God after so many years of discernment, I was given a very specific mission to come here to Spain, where it all began for us, for me to study the foundational documents and the spirituality of the Society of Jesus. In particular, I've been tasked by my provincial with studying the spiritual exercises. Here you see two paintings of Ignatius, St. Ignatius writing that document that our novices spoke about when they went on their 30-day retreat, and you've heard about a little bit with our spirituality. For me to study the exercises and also to study other documents that are foundational to our charism. Now, if you told me 12 years ago that I would be back in studies right after ordination of the priesthood, I would not have believed you. Especially since for me, ever since I first felt called to the priesthood when I was 13, for me, my life as a priest, I was always thinking about how do I get involved in the apostolate, get active as a priest. The origins of my own vocation started with a real call that I heard from the Eucharist, a desire to bring Jesus to people in the Eucharist and to preach the gospel wherever I was needed. And now, though I find myself enjoying beautiful pastoral ministry as a young priest in the parishes of Madrid, hearing confessions, saying masses, my primary mission is to study. So you may ask, you know, how did I get here? If I have such a zealous heart to share the gospel, why am I back in the books? Well, like most things in our life, the change of course for me happened because God intervened. A few years back, during one of my summer breaks, I was given the opportunity to go to a Jesuit retreat house in California. You've heard us talk a little bit about our schools and our social ministries, but another big aspect of our life is retreat ministry. Our retreat houses, much like monasteries, are usually secluded places that welcome visitors to spend time with the Lord in silent prayer, spiritual direction, much like Ignatius did during his convalescence. Maybe in your own discernment, one of the places that you visited to pray was one of these kinds of retreat houses. For me, they were certainly big for my own discernment. I still remember going on specific discernment retreats when I was still in college and finding that God spoke loudest when I got quiet. And like Ignatius's family castle, these places allow for that kind of intimacy with the Lord that can change your life. It was one of these retreat houses that I was in, one of these that I was given the opportunity not to just be on retreat, but to help accompany people as a director. And I gotta tell you, being on the other side of the desk, it was a new dawn for my desire for priestly ministry. What I found happened for me was that I was able to listen to people share their experience of God, how he was moving in their hearts and calling them to conversion. And their experience of God's intimate love changed my life, hearing their witness, which is so unique to our life as Christians, to give witness to each other of how God is working. And I realized in my own heart that my vocation is to be a witness, but also to be a conduit of grace. I can mediate the experience of God for a particular person because these kinds of experiences make all of the difference. As we've been presenting to you, and as you've seen clearly demonstrated how far and wide we go and how far and wide we live, Jesuits are definitely known to be men on the road, for sure, who travel the world wherever there may be greatest need. But the common denominator for all of that is the same search that we have to be men who facilitate an encounter with the living God for those who hunger and thirst for his presence in their lives. Though we travel across land and sea, the most important journey we're interested in is not the journey from Houston to Spain, but the journey of my heart into the heart of Christ. That's it. It's that journey that has set my heart on fire as a Jesuit priest, has made me want to study our charism more deeply, to make me a good priest, a good confessor, a good spiritual director. It's this ministry that brought me back to the books, and I want to learn more. I want to be better at this, to share it with others. With that, before we finish, I thought it'd be really a good idea, and we shared this thought before, that before we left you, to share a little bit of the spirituality that we've been talking about and spend a few minutes of prayer with you. We all remember from our own discernments, and I'm sure it's true with yours, that there's a lot of information, but there's very little quiet. And let's spend some time in quiet because God is speaking. And if God is speaking to you in your heart, well, that's where you'll hear where it is that he wants you to go. So we want to spend a few minutes with you in silence. And I'm going to share with you one of the prayers that's very important to us as Jesuits that you've heard a little bit about from the novices, which is called the examine. It's a way of stopping, listening, and seeing where God may be calling you. And in that listening, maybe hearing a voice, maybe for the first time. So before we leave you, we're going to spend a few minutes before Q&A, and I'm going to guide us through a little contemplation, a little examine. So I just want to invite you to spend a minute. You've heard a lot of words. You've heard a lot of noise. Just take a minute to quiet yourself and find yourself before the Lord. As we begin this examine, we take a moment to see ourselves before God, to see how God sees us. In your mind's eye, put yourself before God and see how he sees you. From that place of repose and silence, in your own words, speak to your God. ask him for the grace to see how he has been leading you in this time of discernment, the many months, the many years, looking back. Ask God for the grace to see how his hand has been guiding you as a shepherd tends to his flock. Confident that the Lord is leading me, confident that God is guiding me through my discernment, through my journey as I learn about different religious communities, as I discern my call. I spend a moment with God calling to mind all of the highlights, those big moments in my life that have brought me to this point in my discernment. Call to mind those moments where God has made himself known. Maybe it was a moment on a retreat. Maybe it was a person at your parish who spoke to you a kind word, encouraging you. Maybe it was your family. Call to mind those moments and see them in your mind's eye as God brings them forth to you. Having those events in your mind, having all of those highlights, and sometimes maybe even dark moments on your path, I spend a moment to ask forgiveness for not always responding with diligence to God's call. Are there moments where I heard his call and ignored it? I spend this last minute of the examine having a conversation with God, as I would to a friend, about where I think he may be asking me to follow. Good and gracious God, we give you thanks for this time of silent repose and examination. We ask your grace upon these men who are trying to find their way and listening to your call in their lives. We ask your blessing upon them and all those who are discerning. Help them, Lord, to see with clarity the path you've laid before them and give them the courage to respond with diligence to the call of the King. We ask all this through Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. Thank you for being with us and thank you for praying with us. I think it's time for a little bit of a Q&A, so I'll pass it back to, I think, Father Robert.
So I know I saw in the chat some questions coming in. Rhonda, I look to you to.
Yes, Father Murphy. To
how we want to field any questions.
Yes, sure. I would love to ask you some questions. And it would be great if, okay, so if we can stop the share screen and get all of you up on the screen, because I would love to ask a variety of questions from several of you. First of all, Father David, thank you. That was beautiful. Not only the exam and beautiful, but I wrote down, God spoke loudest when I got quiet. And I think that is beautiful for everybody to hear, you know, just great advice for all. So thank you for that. It was just really, y'all did a fabulous job, every one of you. So I love this question. Are Jesuits only for geniuses and intellectuals? So my question to you is, are you all brilliant? Is this just, they only take brilliant people, or what is that? Who wants to answer?
I'll jump in because I think I have, it's a bit of a strange route to the Jesuits because most Jesuits come right out of college or maybe with some professional experience. But they usually come in with a bachelor's degree if they enter at 24 like I did. But I did not have a bachelor's degree when I entered. I withdrew from school after fall semester of my junior year because I wasn't doing great in school for one, and I needed some time to sort of figure my life out. So I took a break from school and I moved home, and then I ended up doing, worked as a full-time volunteer, ended up doing a full-time volunteer program to help discern. But that's just to say that you can struggle with school and still desire to be a Jesuit, because I know I have. We are expected to do, philosophy studies and theology studies, advanced, an MDiv in theology, sometimes, maybe something a little more advanced. So that's to say that you're going to be expected to do university work, but you don't need to be brilliant, because I know I'm not, even though I have a lot of brilliant brothers that I share this life with. So
thank you so much for sharing that. I think that was a perfect answer. Okay, so I have got a couple of guys have actually asked this, and so this is perfect. How do you know which province? You guys are in the central and southern province of Jesuits, but Jesuits are all over the globe. So how do you know which one? Do you have to enter the one that you live in, or is there an opportunity to, if by chance you want to enter Central and Southern, you can do that? Father Murphy, you're probably the best one to answer that, but I'm not positive.
Sure. So yes, you have some choice and some flexibility as to which province you join. Traditionally, men usually join the province that they call home. And I say it in that way, not necessarily where they were born or where they grew up, but where they call home. And so, for myself, like, I grew up in New Orleans. I had stayed kind of in the borders of the Central and Southern province my whole life. And so it made sense to me to join the Central and Southern province. But some of my Jesuit brothers who aren't on this call, they might go to, like my friend Father Matt Monig, like, met the Jesuits at Boston College, even though he was from Missouri. And so because he met the Jesuits of the Northeast, and he really found his vocation in the North Jesuits of the Northeast.
All right, Father Murphy, okay? you're coming in and out. Just, I wanted to let you know, okay. your internet's unstable, unfortunately. All
right. If one of the other guys wants to jump in, but
usually you join the province. You can have flexibility. There's flexibility in there. Yeah,
Father. I'll jump in. So before I entered the novitiate, I was actually living in California, and so that's the West Province, and I taught at a Jesuit high school for 3 years there. And I spent time discerning, which province do I enter? And for me, you know, it was which province I felt most at home. I'm originally from New Orleans. I moved to Dallas after Hurricane Katrina, and both of those cities I like to call home. My family lives there. And then I first met the Jesuits in St. Louis, our province, and worked in a school in our province. And so it felt home for me. But, you know, I've come to find that when you enter the society, you're entering a universal order. You're not just entering the Jesuit Central Southern Province. You know, we're connected here in Puerto Rico. We have Jesuits from the Midwest and Jesuits from the East, right? And so we're all in this together, right? This universal order.
Great. Thank you very much for that answer. So tell me, how do you pray? So the Liturgy of the Hours, is everybody praying in common wherever you are located? You're all coming from different places. Do you all gather to then pray each day at certain times? Who wants to answer?
I can take that.
All right.
Yeah, that's actually a really good question, because it's one of the defining characteristics of our foundation is that Ignatius got a special permission for our men to not have to come back from the apostolate to come pray in common. It was so important for Ignatius for us to be available for whatever was needed at any given time in any given location that it became a bit of a challenge to get the guys who were dispersed to come back to a central location to pray the hours. That's not to say that we don't pray the hours, but the hours that we pray are by virtue of our ordination to the diaconate. So the men who are ordained to the diaconate have an obligation to pray the hours by virtue of that ordination. By virtue of our institute, we don't have that obligation in the same way. And so we don't come and pray in common, but many of our men who are not ordained pray the office because it's the prayer of the church. And it's a wonderful way to pray with the church who breathes the Psalms all across the world. But no, we don't have an obligation to come and gather together in common, but many communities that I've lived in enjoy gathering together for evening prayer, gather together on Sundays for Vespers and for benediction, because we like to pray together, even though we don't have that same obligation that those Carmelites that you had before or the Benedictines that you'll have. It's a different charism and way of living that particular call to prayer.
Awesome. And I think Deacon Brian, if you'll take this next question, it's kind of dovetails with Father David's question that he just answered about how then do you, if y'all are all really scattered, how do you focus on that brotherhood? I mean, I know you had talked about having Jesuits from all over, all around you, right? But how do you focus on that brotherhood?
I think there's a lot of ways that we focus on brotherhood among ourselves. Certainly living in common is part of that. We think of community as mission, and that happens first and foremost at the local level. So even if you're part of an international community like I am here in Boston, we still prioritize one another as brothers, and we gather every evening for social and dinner. We have mass together every day as well. And so these kind of foundational aspects that form us as community in the place that we live. Then we also think of ourselves as being brothers as part of a province. So I know personally all the guys who are on this call. When we're in men in formation, we have an annual formation gathering where we come together and spend some time in prayer and reflection and conversation together. We have province events like our annual ordinations, our annual first celebration of first vows for guys finishing the novitiate that brings Jesuits from the province together that then are also kind of functioning together corporately and as community. But then also we think of ourselves as a corporate body globally as well. And that's one of the great gifts and charisms of the Society of Jesus. We also sometimes have apostolates that are forms of bringing us together. I'm the editor-in-chief of the Jesuit Post, which is an online media platform run by Jesuits in formation from the United States. And so we've got about 40 different Jesuits who contribute to that. Ian Peoples, who's on this call, is one of the editors, one of the team leaders for that as well. So that's a way that we maintain some of our characteristic collaboration. And that's something that's done digitally. And so Ian can be in Belize and I can be in here in Boston. And just this week, we can be working on an article together using a Google Doc. So that's just kind of the world we live in. And so there are a lot of ways that we can stay in touch and maintain our sense of community, even with distance.
Awesome. So in any of you, if you want to jump into the chat, I know I'm not going to be able to get to all these questions. If any of you is right at your computer and can kind of answer any of these questions, but one of them I want you to answer is somebody is to, can you work a specific apostolate? Meaning, for example, say you have just like a real heart for spiritual direction like Father David, is that something that's going to be taken into account when figuring out where you're going to go? You know, because boy, if we're talking about global, you guys are global and go everywhere. So what does that look like?
Maybe John and Brother Sullivan, if y'all want to take that one, especially John talking about cura personalis and cura apostolica.
Yeah, so sorry about that. Yeah, we are able to work in specific apostolates, and the discernment that happens with a provincial who is in charge of the province, he's like the big superior, right? And we have conversations with him, and we tell him everything that's going on in our lives. And that includes our struggles, our joys, and our gifts, and our passions, and where the Holy Spirit is calling us in prayer. And it's there's a saying that sometimes we say casually, it's not official, but it's two people discern and one decides, right? So we're going to discern together and be in conversation, but the provincial decides where to send us. But the reason why we share everything in our hearts with him about our struggles, our joys, our passions, and where we feel the Holy Spirit calling us with our talents, he's going to take that into account and mission us where we're going to bring the most life to the greatest number of people where it's most needed. Right, because we're at the needs of the church here. So, and you can be sent on a very specific mission, which is why at Final Vows, Jesuits take that special vow to the Pope, right? So he can send you wherever he wants. It's the church can send us wherever she needs, and it is always taking into account our gifts and also our struggles.
Yeah, that's beautiful. Thank you so much for that. Last question, while I'm going to launch this poll for everybody, is I would love for Richard Manuel, would you tell us your, one of you tell us about maybe the greatest fear before joining, and somebody tell us about the greatest joy of being a Jesuit.
Yeah, for me, the greatest fear, especially coming from Puerto Rico, different culture to an origin in the States, is like integrating to another culture and another language. When I started in Oviche, I didn't know like a much on English, and thanks to the community, the formations and the formatories helped me to feel at ease and to feel at home. And that's something that calmed me and calmed that fear of longing to or becoming to a society. So that's something that I experienced when I entered to SOSI.
I think for me, when I look at my greatest joy, I got to start with my greatest fear, right? I'm afraid of the unknown, right? I didn't know what to expect when I entered the novitiate. And, am I worthy enough to enter in the company of Jesus, right? The Society of Jesus. And, through my experiences, I mean, I'm just overwhelmed with joy by those moments of encountering Christ and the people that I've served and the people I've come into contact with, really feeling that, feeling Christ tangibly, feeling his presence and feeling affirmed and feeling that while I am imperfect and while I might have fears, I have nothing to fear, that Christ is right there with me and that this is where he's called me to. So I'm just overwhelmed with joy, by feeling Christ's presence in the people that I have served. It's just wonderful, wonderful life.
Well, it's been beautiful to get to know all of you, and you have been very helpful, because like 85% of everybody on this call says you have helped them understand religious life more just from this hour. And so many are very interested to find out more about the Jesuits. So that's a beautiful thing. And that's just going to continue as more people watch this. You did an excellent job of succinctly but thoroughly explaining the formation process and what it is to be a Jesuit. And so many people, let's give them a round of applause. Please say everybody thank you to all of you for that. And they will be on, a couple of them will be on for our Discerners Hour. So be looking forward to that. So thank you, everybody. God bless you.
Thank everyone, you. God bless your discernment. You're all in our prayers.
Thanks, yes.